Louis Theroux joins us now. Hey, Louis, great to see you. Now, you gave this new book of yours a 5-star review on Amazon. Tell us, how honest were you being when you gave that review?
That's a great question. And I gave it 5 stars on Goodreads. I hit all the different formats. I would say I was being totally honest, you know, but I was also factoring in how much work I put into it. So I wrote it during a pandemic, during lockdown, when I had kids at home. So it wasn't the easiest book to write. I have 3 boys and one of them's only 6 years old. He was 5 at the beginning of the pandemic. He's actually 7 now. It tells you how long I've been doing this. But I don't know how many of you have been doing homeworking or people at home who can relate to this, like the idea of having kids at home while you're trying to do, you're stressed about work. It's not easy. So I may have marked myself a little more kindly because I knew the hell that I went through to write it.
Well, does it hurt that only 6 people found your review helpful?
I think it might be up to 7 or 8 by now.
Listen. Are they fake accounts you've created?
It's a fascinating book, but how difficult was it to turn the microscope on your own family?
It was relatively straightforward for me because it's sort of my job. I just had to be unsparing and forensic and try and peel back the layers in the way that I normally do on other people and their or in fact, on prisons or in porn sets. I needed to apply that to my family. I think the challenge was doing it in a way that my own family didn't find stressful or too exposing. My wife, Nancy, is probably the most ambivalent about the book. My kids don't care. I'm too irrelevant for them to really, you know, like for me to be, I don't feature in their world so far as I can tell, other than as a sort of risible figure of sort of a wannabe figure of authority. It was a different experience sort of bringing, they say, excuse my English, they say don't urinate in your drinking water.
I've made that. They do say that. God, I wish someone had told me that before I urinated in my drinking water.
And sometimes I felt like I was doing that a bit. Do you know what I mean? But here we are. I've got the book. I did it. I'm proud of it.
Yeah. And so. It's got 5 stars on Amazon reviews, according to you. So that's great.
And I'm just hearing that now it's at 7 or 8 people. 8 people now found that a useful review.
That's the power of the project.
Well, speaking of the pandemic, it's strangely allowed us to see inside celebrities' lives in ways we never really have before. Like, physically, we see their kitchens and their lounge rooms and their life in the background or whatever. And it surprised me with you because you've always been very good at being able to work with other people even though they're vastly different from you, but not really overwhelming with the shape of yourself. So how comfortable are you now with, like, exposing yourself in the nicest possible way?
Well, I'm more comfortable now than I was. I mean, it's been a sort of process that I've gone through. When I started in TV, I thought it was really important that I kind of drew a veil of mystery over who I really was or my personal life. And then, you know, I've been doing this 25 years and I just realized no one really cares that much whether I'm being, like, mysterious. You know, I'm not Banksy. No, you know, I'm not the Scarlet Pimpernel. Do you know what I mean? People can Google me. And I figured, actually, if I'm going to be peering into other people's lives, maybe for me to be open about struggles that I've had or things that I've gone through, or just the banal nature of what it means to be a 51-year-old man, like, maybe that's part of how I, you know, maybe that's part of the job as well. So it didn't happen overnight, but, you know, 2 days ago, you know, it's been incremental. 2 days ago, I found myself sharing a topless selfie on Instagram, which was a totally new frontier. Yeah, in self-exposure, I'm like, is this really me? And I'm like, yeah, who cares? There it is. Yeah, why not? Stick it out there. I've done my Joe Wicks workout, and I thought, you know, I'm going to talk about working out and mental health, and I'm going to put it out there. I'm going to, you know, I felt like, am I one of those people who does that? Like, yeah, maybe I am. Here it is.
Yeah, you are. Next thing you'll be doing, trout pout.
I thought you were going to say, next stop be doing the bottom half.
Oh, well, after the show. Because people are calling it. People are calling the photo that you posted your Louis Theroux trap. Now, surely that's better than the title King of Documentaries.
I would say so. Someone had to explain to me what that meant. I had an idea, but I just needed it confirmed. I'd never heard the phrase thirst trap, let alone Theroux trap. Yeah. It doesn't trip off the tongue.
And you now wish you'd never heard it, is that right?
Kind of, yeah. I think I'll stick to King of Documentaries.
You've interviewed some pretty wild people, to say the least. Have you kept in touch with any of those kind of interview subjects?
Yeah, I mean, and in fact, during lockdown, when I couldn't travel, one of the projects that I did was to do a four-part retrospective about my old programs, going back to Weird Weekends, in which I did Zoom calls with various people who'd stuck in my mind, and caught up with them to see how they were doing sort of 20 years, 25 years on. And the striking thing was, you know, it's been a weird 2 years. I think we can all acknowledge that. And and so in a funny way, the people that as a specialist in weirdness, the people I'd been speaking to had different insights into what we'd been through. But the one that was most apropos and relevant was the guy who thought the world was about to end 25 years ago, called Mike Kane. And it was almost like, okay, finally people are getting it, right? Yes. You know, and he saw it as part of a planned sort of conspiracy, like they're trying to get us all in line. The masks, come on, Louis, read the tea leaves. You know what's going on. He thought it was all part of the finally, like people are understanding what I've been talking about for 25 years. And he'd formerly been up on a mountaintop in Idaho predicting the end of the world. And now he was down in Texas somewhere, a big supporter of Donald Trump. Maybe I shouldn't be surprised, but he felt like everything had come true for him. It was a dream scenario.
Except the world actually ending.
Exactly. Well, that's what I mean. Yeah, he felt like this is it. This is the world. Well, yes, it hadn't ended. I mean, if you want to get technical, the world hadn't ended.
We're still here interviewing you in the real world.
Yeah. At least the pandemic has made one person happy, Louis.
Exactly. Yes, yeah, it hadn't killed the whole world, but it had seriously messed with a lot of lives, and that was enough for him.
Yes, and everyone loves to say, I told you so.
Exactly. Imagine how happy he would be if the world actually ended. He'd be there on a fiery ball going, "We finally, thank you."
Louis's book, Theroux the Keyhole, is available right now. Louis, thanks for joining us on the project, and Merry Christmas.
Thanks for having me. Lovely to see you. Merry Christmas.
Well, Lisa and I are off to write some 5-star reviews for our books on Amazon.
Yes. What a great... I never thought of that before.
No, we'll do it now.